Coming up on the show, we take a look at the new service map capability that provides dependency discovery and mapping across Windows and Linux in the cloud, on-prem, or hybrid environments. We'll show you how it helps you to automatically discover app and system dependencies to accelerate troubleshooting and root cause analysis, and expedite your app and workload migrations, whether you're migrating to the cloud or other destinations. So I'm joined by Nick Burling, who leads the team building Service Map. Welcome.
Hey, Matt. Great to be here.
So with the complexity and dynamic nature of today's applications, everyone's always looking to improve their troubleshooting, right?
Exactly. And really, that's what we're trying to help here with Service Map. One of the biggest problems we see with our customers, IT pros, is just understanding the interdependencies across all of the different VMs and systems that make up their applications. Usually, our customers have a variety of manual tools and processes that they're trying to cobble together. And we're really trying to eliminate that error-prone manual work by providing automated discovery of application and system dependencies.
So you're not looking at dependencies like versions of the .NET framework or Java?
Great question. No, so really we're looking at this from the perspective of network dependencies, but at the OS and at the process level. So if you think about this, by being able to automatically discover all different processes, another way of thinking about it is, if it talks TCP, we can discover and see it. Mm-hmm. So what you can think of is, what if I have all of my VMs that are part of an app? And what if I can discover all of my Windows and Linux systems? If I can discover the components running on my front-end web tier, but then be able to see all of the different connections from that front-end web tier through my app tier back through my database. Then when you start to overlay that with performance data, with change detection, all of the things that we have within the log analytics platform, mm-hmm. now you can start to really start to narrow down, quickly isolate bottlenecks, and pinpoint where the problem is.
So what types of processes might it detect?
So you mentioned Java and .NET before. So certainly Java applications, .NET, but really the key thing, like I said, if it talks TCP, we can discover it and see it. So that can be packaged applications, that can be homegrown applications. Literally anything that's firing up and making connections in the OS, we're going to be able to discover and see those dependencies.
Awesome. So can we see it in action?
Absolutely, yeah. So let's take a scenario. Let's say I'm the web admin within my Acme web application environment. And let's say I just got an alert that said, you know, hey, this morning around 4 a.m., people are starting to complain that the app was having issues. And we're seeing exceptions. People are complaining about slowness. So how would I normally tackle that? Well, I might be able to pull up any of the free web availability monitoring tools. And mm-hmm. as we can see here, my Acme web app is green across all of the different geos where we're deployed. So what would I do next? Well, I'm the web admin, so I may want to come in and start to look at performance for my web server. So I've got a simple little search that I've saved here. We're using the log analytics solution right here. And what we've done is just do a simple search to be able to show me and graph out CPU performance for that web server.
Right.
This thing's not even batting an eyelid. It's less than 10% CPU utilization. So now what do I do? So typically we would see customers get on the bridge call. Everyone's got their own tools saying, oh, it's not my problem, right? Mm-hmm. Well, what I've been able to do is actually go sign up for the Insight and Analytics solution, which is part of the operations management suite, and that's how you actually get access to Service Map.
Right.
So here what I'm looking at is my OMS dashboard. We can see an overview of all the different solutions that I've got, and here we can see Service Map. Now, before I actually jump in and start showing this, I want to show you how easy it is to get started using Service Map.
Right.
So notice right here we've got 18 different systems connecting in. Well, all I need to do to get started is come to the configuration page, download a Windows or a Linux agent, mm-hmm. and get it installed in my systems, and we're up and running. Now, in the interest of time, I've gone ahead and downloaded the Windows agent here, our dependency agent, onto a VM. This happens to be one of my front-end web servers. All I have to do is double-click that, and it's going to walk me through a simple wizard to install it. Now, I'm using an interactive installer. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you can install this using silent installation. You could use Config Manager. You could use Chef, Puppet, really any of your software distribution tools.
And fully automate that process.
You got it, exactly. Right. So now if I refresh my screen, we should see that number go up to 19, showing that that agent is automatically connected up into the service, and we're actually now starting to monitor it.
Right.
So there we go. We can see the 19.
Great.
So now let's drill in. Right now I've got my front-end web servers here. We can see on the left a list of all the different systems that are connected into Service Map, a mixture of Windows, mixture of Linux. And here's our front-end web server. Now, as I zoom in a little bit, what we're seeing is all the TCP-connected processes running in that particular OS And the key thing, there are other processes running in the background, right? But really what we're interested in, what are those things that are firing up and making connections that are interrelated that might have something to do with this issue we're trying to troubleshoot? So I can see my Acme customer portal application. And right off the bat, you're going to see a whole bunch of back-end systems here. So let's say I go expand one of these. Where you just see the IP address here and a port, what that's showing you is a system where we don't have an agent installed. It's a remote system, but at least I can still show you that there is a dependency there. Mm-hmm. And right off the bat, your eye is going to get drawn right here, right? And as I expand this out, this is actually our application server. You can see the Tomcat process. And we're actually showing that there's an alert on that particular system. So as I load this up, what we're doing here is we're actually integrating in with log analytics. So on the back end, we're able to pull things like alerts, and we're going to talk about other different types of data. Mm-hmm. And in this case, we can see, as I expand, this particular machine, my app server, is showing that it had high CPU. In fact, it crossed a threshold of 90%. Right? So clearly something I may want to drill in. So as a reminder, right, I'm the web admin. I don't necessarily own that machine, but I've been able to very quickly start to drill in and isolate an issue here before I ever had to go get people on a bridge call or anything like that.
Yeah, and it's across Windows and Linux, as we've said.
You got it, exactly right. So now that we've seen there's an issue there, let's actually shift our focus to that particular application server. So now what I've done is load up a map, and we can actually start to see kind of our three-tier application right here, right? Mm-hmm. I've got my front-end web servers, Tomcat, I've got a back-end database, but we're seeing another couple interesting things. So actually, there's this backup process right here. It's actually trying to make a connection somewhere. Where you see that dotted red line, that's actually showing you failed connections. And as I start to think about that, okay, a little strange. There's this backup.pl. In fact, I don't know about you, but I don't know many processes that are Perl that are backup products. But anyway, and we can see right around the same time, there's the CPU issues. But there's another really important thing. When I come back to our summary here, we're actually able to start to go in and look at other kinds of things. Now remember, I told you that people were starting to complain about that app right around 4 in the morning. So let's go back in time here. So I'm going to go set this up for 4 a.m. I'm going to make it a 20-minute window. We were looking at a 10-minute window there, so we can just see what's going on. So now it's going to load up a view of that exact same machine. So there we can see my backup process. There's failed connections during this time range as well. We're seeing more of those alerts. But you'll see something else here. We actually can detect that there was actually a change, a software change made to the system right around the time that people are starting to complain about these issues. And in fact, it's actually that backup process. So again, kind of a weird backup process. Right around the same time we're seeing these issues, trying to make connections out to remote systems, but that's failing, starting to look a little bit strange here. So now let me go in and drill into log analytics so we can start to see, does that thing actually seem to be associated with the performance problems that we're seeing for that one machine? So what I've done is I've clicked into log analytics. Here we can see that one particular change event. But I want to actually look at performance. And so to keep things fast here, I've gone ahead and saved off a simple search, just going to show me CPU performance for that particular VM. Mm-hmm. Wow, we can see some nasty spikes right there. I'm actually going to change this. Let's go look over a little bit of a broader time range over the last 6 hours. Yeah, I mean, look at that, just continuing to hammer the CPU. So let's kind of try and go to the last mile here and look at what are the top five processes, top processes on that system that are chewing up that CPU. And there you go. As I highlight, the backup.pl process is right there, and it's looking pretty guilty.
Yeah. So your root cause analysis, you've identified this as the key offender.
Exactly right.
So can we automate a fix for this?
Ah, great question. So when we start to think about all the alerting and the capabilities that are part of OMS as a whole, as I click into the alerts view, well, here's our high CPU alert. I'm going to go into the edit view. And one of the things we'll see over here on the right is there's a set of actions that you can take off of any of these alerts. So your requisite, go send an email, other things like webhooks, right? So I can start to integrate into third-party systems. But if you look right here, runbooks, right? So I could come in, let's say, for example, I see that process. It's looking conspicuous, like might even be malware, right? I mean, it's getting installed. It's just hammering the CPU. It's trying to connect out. Well, I could actually execute a quarantine VM runbook from right here, right? And just automate that, pull it off the network, particularly if you're in dynamic scaling environments where you don't worry about the app going down when you're taking an instance out. So absolutely, you can tie an automation here.
Isolate that one, replace it with another, for instance.
Exactly right.
So this covered troubleshooting an issue with a production application as an example, but this could be very useful in dev and test environments as well.
Absolutely. So a lot of our customers will start to kind of look at leveraging Service Map and its capabilities earlier in the dev cycle as well. Think about as I'm starting to stand up my apps in a pre-prod environment, I'm doing testing. I want to verify that all my network connectivity is looking right. And I want to identify issues before I ever roll them out to production. So we see a lot of customers using it really across all of the different phases of the app lifecycle.
So this capability as well, level of visibility, would be very useful in scenarios where you need to be aware of those system dependencies for migration, for instance?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, you know, particularly now with cloud migration being such a hot area. And that's exactly right. So if you look at the map and this visibility that we're giving, you know, one of the things that we see with a lot of customers is, you know, challenges around migration where they're not aware of those cohort of systems that really need to move together. Mm-hmm. Whether that's I'm moving an AD farm or I'm moving out my databases, what apps depend on those databases, what are back-end and front-end dependencies that I may not be aware of, and before I actually start to move that workload, I want to make sure I'm not going to break anything.
Yeah.
So if you look at this view, all of the APIs that sit behind this are available as external REST APIs to customers, to partners, et cetera. And here's a little example. It's a dashboard that we've put together, basically a migration report. It's leveraging that API right in Power BI, and we can start to have some really nice capabilities where we can get a list of all the different servers that we need to migrate. I can click here and start to filter. This happens to be all of the systems that are running Windows. And I'm not just seeing a list of the servers, but I also see all the different dependencies. And so I really can start to share that off across my other tools and processes within the org as we're going through that migration process.
And migrate the whole app and all of its dependencies. You don't miss anything.
Exactly right. I mean, probably the number one thing that we see with customers is where they miss those unknown dependencies, and that, you know, A, can break services now, but then also when they go to stand it up in the new environment, things aren't configured correctly.
And this will really help you create a very detailed inventory of all the VMs you want to migrate for that particular app.
That's exactly it. That's exactly it.
Awesome. So when we think about the next steps, where are we going?
Great question. So as I've shown you here, some integration with alerts and change. We're really just going to continue down that path, right? So we've got some really exciting new services that are part of OMS, both in the insight and analytics capabilities and in automation control, like updates. What if I could show you if any of these systems are missing critical security updates? What if I can now start to be dependency aware when I'm scheduling my updates, right? Mm-hmm. I want to build my maintenance windows around all of the systems that need to be updated together. Other services like backup, right? Want to be able to do dependency and application aware backup and site recovery. And that migration use case is another great one, right? Where you can actually use site recovery to fail your apps over to the cloud. Well, we're going to be looking at tying these things together to be able to automate a lot of that.
Yeah, fail them all over and ensure that the relevant VMs start in a certain order.
Exactly right. As you're building your recovery plan, you want to make sure that sequence is correct, and we can automate a lot of that manual process.
Awesome. So how do people get started today?
It's really easy. You can come to microsoft.com/OMS, and there's a URL right below that you can go to, a friendly one. And there's really a couple easy ways to get started. One, it's free to go create a subscription, connect some VMs, and you're off and running. You can even come in and just get access to a demo where you can really come in and play with one of our environments even before you start to deploy it in yours.
Great stuff. Well, thanks, Nick, for the overview. And of course, keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for the latest updates. Thanks for watching, and bye for now.